us twice. As of now, I'm still a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Had a person visits, I've never seen him before. He says, I'm the pastor of the local Seventh-day Adventist Church. We attended there, we helped fill it up, but the conference come in and did a split, and I want to make this real quick. Yes, if he could take, I'm almost at the very beginning. Since you're not attending, can we take your name off the church book? I said, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I'm living the lifestyle of a Seventh-day Adventist. If you want to take my name off the book, you can do it. The local church can do it. It has blood on your shoulder. He was on his way to go to a foreign theological thing. He was just sent there for a purpose. Most people said, either join another church or said, yes, take your name off. I don't want to know. Within about 3 weeks of his visit, he did write us a letter and say that the church accepted our wishes. About 2 weeks after we got the letter, I got a call from, it was a very small church. I mean, we're talking about, at one time when we were involved there, it was like 35 members, and it dropped down to usually less than 10 in attendance. Jack, we don't have a pastor right now. Will you come and lead out in prayer meeting? And what I want to tell you is that head elder of that church did not know what the pastor was doing. He didn't know he was going around asking people to take their names off the doors. That's the duty of the local church, not the conference of the pastor.
That's right.
I could go on and on. We could all go on and on. But we came into this message. What I wanted to say is that the righteous by faith and what I'm going to present here this afternoon was given to me in the early 90s. Most of what I'm presenting to you this afternoon, in fact, when I look back at my notes and decide what I was going to talk about, the date on it was 1993 that I last basically read. So with the things that's happened recently, relatively in the last few years, some of these people involved with what's going on in the split up and the work between the ministries had this information in 2010. That's caused a lot of commotion. Now, I'm going to tell you, when I first started studying, I had one principle. When I read something in the Bible, Spirit of Prophecy, I looked in the mirror. I said, does this apply to me? I looked at my family. Now I looked at the church. So I'm not here to point out different things. The unity issue starts in the home. Just about everything I'm going to say here this afternoon, we can apply to our relationship with their spouse and with their children and our relatives. We have some very clear, inspired references on this. I'm wishing to share that with you this afternoon. So, those up toward the front say, oh, he's talked about him over here, and he's talked about him, and those over back there said, no pointing fingers. Each, if you don't point fingers, each point to yourself. Okay, I just want to make that clear. Because I'm not going to name any names. I'm not going to name any ministries. Okay? So I just want to make that clear that I'm not here to... I'm just here because I want to see us be united. Because Christ prayed for us to be united. He prayed for his disciples. He also included us in that prayer. And we're not. I've been told by a number of ministry leaders, starting back in the mid-80s, unity will never happen. We have tried it many times. This is Neil for prayer. Our Father in heaven, We thank you so much for the opportunity of each of us to come here, to fellowship with each other, to get instruction from your word, Father. Please be with us and guide us. Direct us, and I pray that the Holy Spirit will bring to my memory the things that I have believed over a number of years, the things that you have impressed us with. Guide us, dear Father. Direct us. Lead us in paths of righteousness. Father, we know that when you lead us and direct us, we will be one with you and one with another. Please show us how we can do this. All this we ask in your dear Son's name. Amen. The theme of this campaign is preparing for the last days. And I wanted my wife to speak, but she said, no, you got too much to share. I just wanted, you know, some things that hasn't been said from what I understand, some things that we need to be concerned about. There's going to be a time of trouble before the close of probation, and we're going to be on our own. We won't be able to buy ourselves. We need to do some preparation for that. We need to have a garden. We can't put things, everything in the freezer. Our electric's going to be turned off. We're bread and water is promised after the close of probation, as I understand it. Our food is almost all processed. It's not good for us. If it's in a box or a can, most of it's not good for us. The water, if we have public water, it's contaminated. If we have a well, it's contaminated. What are we going to do when there's no electric? We bought a place 4 years ago, and my one concern, it didn't have a good source of water. That was one of my primary things. There is a solution to that today. A couple years ago, I was looking into it. It's going to cost a couple $1,000. Now for around $200, you can turn your electric pump into a hand pump. Without doing any more drilling or anything, you can get the supplies for about $200. God's ways is always simple and always affordable. The well driller that's going to help me some on this, he says, I've dug two wells, one with a hand pump and one. Yeah, we don't have to dig another well. So he says there's people around. A lot of people are preparing for these type of things. How are we going to heat ourselves in wintertime? A lot of our houses don't have fireplaces. How are we going to cook without electricity? Wilderness survival. There's a lot of people into this wilderness survival and things, how to survive off the land for months and years. Keep it simple. I'm not sure we need to do that. I think, and I've always wondered all my life, when are we going to know to leave everything? When is it presumption? When's the Lord leading? If you have any input into this, please share it with me. But as we were reading not long ago, it dawned on me. The angels came to Lot. It says, nothing. God has promised to send his angels to us. And I think that's a type of what we can trust. A lot of our problems is, has been touched on a couple times here already, is that we trust looking to other people. We were told before we went to school, whether it's primary or whatever, or when we went to first grade, do what the teacher says. You need to do that to a first grader. We have never made a transition into thinking for ourselves. Many people read the Bible every year. Not many, but some people read the Bible every year. Some people read the Bible many times. Many of those people are Sunday keepers. Many of those people believe eternal torment. Man, those people believe all kinds of things. When you read, you don't get anything. Christ's object lesson tells us that we need to dig deep. We need to study. The Bible says to study to show thyself approved. Most people spend more time on reading newsletters and books of people and theologians than they do reading the Word of God, including inspiration, which we will say a little bit later. I equal those two together. I personally do. We look to man. Jeremiah says, cursed is a man that trusts in man. It's like going to a desert and looking for something worthwhile. Blessed is a man who trusts in the Lord. It's like going to a fertile place along a river. There is a big difference. Bless and curse. If God says something is blessed, if something is cursed, we need to pay attention to what he's talking about. It is very difficult because we're here. Most people do not have anybody else to meet with. My wife and I have nobody to meet with for about 3 hours drive one way. That makes it difficult. But God has promised to be with us, and he will send his angels to those who cannot go out. Angels are sent to animate, cheer, and bless the scattered people. Easiest reference is that I may know him, page 154. That's a wonderful promise. But my wife and I, we have a very good study relationship. Every morning and evening, we have a study. We read, we meditate, we devour. We don't just read a little devotional and close the books and we're done. At Sabbath, we usually read a chapter or two and sometimes more. And we study it. We read two verses, then we go back and analyze and think. We don't just read it. We need to get out of just reading. We need to think about what we're reading. We need to go and check and see what other scriptures say when we're on a certain topic. Because the principle of the Bible and the spirit of prophecy is line upon line, not just read something. Especially the Bible. Because the Bible, the doctrine, you've got to hunt and pick for different things on a certain topic. We've lost that ability for the most part. People don't know how to study. And we're told many times, there's a couple interesting ways she puts it, every earthly support will be cut off. We will be forbidden to buy or sell. We're talking about God's people. Jesus invites us to come to him, and he will lift the weights from our weary shoulders and place upon his yoke. The path in which he invites us to walk should never have cost us a pang, as we always walk in it. It is when we stray from the path of duty that the way becomes difficult and thorny. It is safe to go to every earthly support. Let go of every earthly support and take the hand of him who lifted up and saved the sinking disciple from the stormy sea. We should place ourselves on the Lord's side, and when we have done this, then with childlike confidence, I love little children that have confidence in things. They can be up 8 foot high in the air and jump. Daddy will catch you. They jump. We should have confidence to believe what Christ tells us to do. True and abiding happiness can never be derived from any human being. We may have special select friends that all are perceived and unacknowledged by us. We place in the heart where God should be, and we can never perfect a realm, full Christian experience until every earthly support is removed and the soul surrenders its entire affections about God. opportunity, possibly. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. 1 John 4:11. If ye speak the same things, that there be no division among you. 1 Corinthians 1:10. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Amos 3:3. Till we come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man. Does that relate to this group at all? Can we have unity without those two according to Ephesians 4? Unity of faith, of what we believe, and the measure and stature of the fullness of Christ. The nature of Christ is what it's talking about here with the Father. Whereas the body is one, the body does not fight against itself. There is a unity in the physical body, and there's a unity in Christ's body. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. The world can see if we are united. Other worlds are watching us. They know. But your neighbor is watching. The other people that you associate with is watching to see if you're a Christian, if you're united among one another. And again, this can be directed right to our own family. I and them, the prayer of Christ in John 17, I and them and thou and me, that they may be perfect and one, that's his followers, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them, that's followers of Christ, that includes us.
John 17:23.
Thou hast loved them, or loved us, as thou hast loved me. Many times, Ellen White talks about God loving us like he loves his dear son. That's why he sent his son, because his love for us. How can there be a unity of spirit when each ministry or each believer, each family or whatever, is not united on the truth? Husband and wife, many times their families split up. If we unite in the spirit and not on truth, why not go back to the structure? Or even go back to Rome? If we're not going to unite on doctrine, because we're commanded here that we need to unite as we unite on Christ. Christ is not divided. Inspiration does not support pluralistic teachings on what day to worship, on many other different issues. Now, I'm going to deal with this more tomorrow than I am right now, but I'm just going through something else. It has been brought out here many times already. God cannot do something. Well, he really technically can. But it's not his character, his nature to force us or to make us choose. But God cannot, or it says, say, God does not work with anyone that's not humble or teachable. There is some very smart, very brilliant ministry leaders. And I'm thinking right now outside of the Godhead movement that won't even listen to us. They're doing a wonderful work. They're reviving, you know, the people. And we could thank them. Some of them I'm very close to. We know each other by name. We've known them for years. I don't have time to talk to you about that. Now, that's okay if once, if he's busy. But he's never treated that way to me before. That's a sign of not being humble or teachable. God can bring a child to some of us and ask a question. Jesus never turned a child away. He never turned anybody away for a simple question. At 12 years old, he was asking questions. Some of the best things to do is ask with some people when you're talking yesterday about witnessing. Some of the best things to do is ask them questions. That's one of Christ's methods he used. What do you think about this teaching? What the Bible says this, what do you think about that? There are two main parts in this prayer, John 17. This is a quote from Review and Herald, March 4, 1890. The first is to become sanctified. To fulfill the prayer of Christ in John 17, we must become sanctified, or to be made holy through his word, the word of truth. The second is to unite with other believers so we can be one in Christ. Unity with others is only achieved by uniting with Christ.
Amen.
There is no dissension at the foot of the cross. If we draw a knot, nigh to God, we shall draw nigh to one another. We cannot draw nigh to the same cross without coming into unity of the Spirit. Now, there is one good quote there for the unity of the Spirit that people are talking about. But some are talking about the unity of the Spirit without unity of doctrine. We believe pretty much what we want as long as we only handle maybe three or four or five basic things, and then we can believe a bunch of different things. Satan is busy misinforming people, making them believe they cannot do what God has commanded us. He has deceived most Christians in believing they cannot stop sinning. Satan is doing everything in his power to keep this from happening. He is leading us to believe we cannot become pure and holy, a powerful people separate from the world, united in love and union with one another. We need to review how our pioneers got united. The first volume of Testimonies, page 86, there was 35 people assembled, got together. They each had different views. They each were taught of God, so they said. Probably two of them agreed. Before they closed the meeting, they each yielded up their errors. That's what the church started on, brothers and sisters. That's our pattern. Are we willing to do that? And they gave up their errors and were united. God greatly blessed them and added to their numbers. We can also go back to when Christ died. In the upper room, you remember, they were bickering. I go sin right or left, or where am I going to be in your kingdom, Lord? Within a couple of weeks, they were again in the upper room, and it was a larger crowd. Acts 1, read it very carefully. I don't want to take the time to go through it because that's something you need to study. They were united. They weren't bickering about who's going to be the first or who's going to be the greatest or whatever. They were united, and then what happened? The early rain was poured out. The gospel went to the whole populated Christian world, or that area. That's our model. In our separation from one another, we are close to Christ. Is that right? In our separation from one another, we are separated from Christ. We want to press together. Oh, how many times will I seem to be in the presence of God and holy angels? I have heard the angels' voice saying, press together, press together, press together. Do not let Satan cast his hellish shadow between brethren. Press together. I didn't repeat that more than she wrote it. That's in Second Selected Messages 374. Are we to press together? Or are we just kind of be distance and be friends and work along together? Do we really realize our need of uniting with Christ and following His way? Harmony and unity existing above the men of varied dispositions. Another word for that is different temperaments. My temperament is different than anybody else's here. Do not use your temperaments as an excuse for not overcoming. Use your temperaments to build on. To know where you need to improve. Know your strong and weak points. Say, I'm a redhead and I was born this way and I got, you know, that's just the way I am. It's the way God made me. That doesn't work. Because we're all sinners. We weren't born that way, but we've all chose that. We're born with a sinful nature, bent to sin. But we're born to make a choice. We are predestined, by the way. Everybody here is predestined to be saved and to accept Christ. So I do believe in predestination. God's people in unity with one another, there will be no discordant opinions among those who are taught of God. When we will bring our hearts into unity with Christ, so it needs to be our heart and our lives into harmony with His work, the Spirit that descended upon the day of Pentecost will fall upon us. She started writing that in 1884, before 1888. Those who have learned of Christ will manifest in all their intercourse a humble, teachable spirit. Humble, teachable. A lot of times I don't see that. Every ever willing to receive counsel or correction. Again, the fingers are pointing back at me. Because, you know, I said earlier, I'm a researcher. I'm not a public speaker. I'm a researcher. And when I send something out, I usually say, if I've overlooked something, if I've neglected something, please tell me. I want to study that out. We each need to have that spirit. Do I have that all the time? You might not think so. I try to. The Lord confers upon His servants varying gifts. Now listen to this next statement. This should humble every ministry leader, every pastor, every conference president, every dot, 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 whatever. no one person possesses all the qualifications essential in carrying forward the work of God. Hence, no one is qualified to act independently in all matters pertaining to the Lord's cause. In the body of Christ, there is the same law of dependence, the same necessity for harmony of action that exists in the human body. Then she first quotes 1 Corinthians 12 to 27 that we've already slightly covered. While no one member of the church is complete in himself, all combined form a perfect whole. The reference there in 1 Corinthians 12 refers, remember, the hand needs the leg and the arm, you know, body and arm and feet and everything. Our body is a complete whole. The eye is not more important than the ears. Well, I'd rather lose my ears than I would my eyes. Maybe there's a little difference there. But they don't, the ears, even though they're one of the closest things together, they don't play one another. Our call is, come out from among them, be ye separate, and the tabernacle should be set apart decidedly for those who are true and loyal. This is from Paulson Collection 330, continuing. Those who have denied their faith and who would now tear down that which in the past years they have labored to build up should understand that they have no lot nor part in the faith that has firmly held the people of God in unity. You do not know how earnestly they will work to get possession of the tabernacle, but this must now not be permitted. In no case should a decidedly opposing element be permitted in the tabernacle. Is unity easy to do? Can we say, I want to get together and get half a dozen people or half a dozen ministry leaders or whatever together and say, I want ministry, you know, we need to get together. Most of those don't want to come. Or I'll come if I can dominate. Let me read you a statement. Unity existing among the followers of Christ is an evidence that the Father has sent His Son to save sinners. It is a witness to His power, for nothing short of a miraculous power of God can bring human beings with their different temperaments together in harmonious action, their one aim being to speak the truth in love. Well, that's a pretty easy reference to find. I don't hear it quoted very much. That's in the 9th volume of the Testimonies. It's a miracle of God, but we need to be a part of that miracle and work in His way. Did you know that Jesus Christ had to be made perfect through suffering? Set of Watchman 1905. Christ, who was a divine Son of God, made perfect through His trials, through His human nature. We'll talk about human divine nature more tomorrow. Because it's already been mentioned a couple times, we need to take on the divine nature. And what the devil wants us to do is get from one rut that we can't stop sinning into that we are perfectionists and we cannot sin. Truth has been brought out already. The truth is usually in the middle. But the devil doesn't care if we carry a Bible around. He doesn't care if we open it up and open it up and start studying it. Because 99.9999% of the time, he can get us sidetracked into some rut that he wants us in, that man is made. And he is made. He shakes his boot. His boots when he sees we're asking God for divine guidance. And we have a contrite, teachable spirit. Then he becomes concerned. But when we just get open and read our Bible, he knows that most Christians are deceived that and treasure to say most simply of us, profess simply of us. But we don't, we claim to be a remnant of a remnant. We need to get out of the different ruts that he has made and that man has made. Third selected message is 352. Write this one down. 352, third selected message. It's another one that was pressed together. Now, I looked up, I tried to, I didn't look it up. But I didn't have it, I don't have it in my notes here. There's one reference that if you want to get it, I'll see that you get it tomorrow if I have a request. Now, it says, press together, gain warmth from the coldness of others. It's pretty hard to do that without getting upset, isn't it? Isn't our natural tendency to those that oppose us and things, we press together, sometimes we get heated debates. But we're not to do that. Christ, never by look, by gesture, ever lost his cool. He is our pattern. Sometimes we take these things personally. I have learned and usually remember that when people oppose what I'm presenting and what I stand for, that they're really opposing what God is talking. Press together is a command I hear from the captain of our salvation. Press together. Where there is unity, there is strength. Every army knows that. Every football team knows that. Where there's unity, there's strength. All who are on the Lord's side will press together. There is need of perfect unity and love among the believers in the truth. And anything that leads to dissension is of the devil. The Lord designs that his people shall be one with him as the branches and are of one with the vine. They will be one with each other. Some of these trees out here, you see the branches, which is us, fighting against the trunk? You don't see that. There is so many instances in nature that can be assimilated to how we're to live and how we're to learn and how we're to work with one another. We're to have perfect unity with Christ. It sounds obvious, doesn't it? But we need to let self die. This is the problem, is this right here. We don't realize our selfishness. Do I need to repeat that? Less self die, then everyone will be imbued with the Spirit of Christ to work, not in his own mind or will, but in perfect unity with Jesus Christ. May the Lord come very near to you that you may be bright and shining light to those in darkness. Can you imagine being in heaven, sitting around a conference table, for instance, acting like we do here? And we'll cover this more tomorrow. The second coming, our characters are not going to be changed. The way we treat one another will not be changed. How long is it going to take us to learn this? We're all to be united in Christ, and we are ever to be ready to make an improvement that the Lord, through His different agencies, may tell us we should make. The Lord desires His worker to make constant improvement. We're not going to gain this overnight. We can't, you know, just like overcoming our sinful nature and learning about righteousness by faith. There's no such thing as instant sanctification. Some Adventists have taught it and some still believe it. More on that tomorrow. There's no such thing as instantly being made perfect. Yes, at the cross, when we accept Christ, we're looked upon perfect. But we've got to continue to study and to learn. We must do the best we can under all circumstances, all counseling together, and much earnest prayer to God for wisdom. Need to be perfect with others. There's a narrow path. Brothers and sisters, one of the people when I was in the academy taught me. He was discussing some things with a couple of us boys while we were on the walk. He says, you know, the nature of people and relationship is usually when you first meet each other, you try to see what you got in common with them. Then after you become good friends, after a time, you start pointing out all the differences in each other and find out you don't want to be friends. How many times has that happened in marriage? People get together, and once they're together, oh, we're not compatible. That's our human nature. When we get close to one another, but we're depressed together and with Christ, it's just like a hub of a wheel. Put Christ in the middle of that hub. The wheel, the outer part of an old, like an old wagon wheel with spokes on it, is the world that we came out of. And we are the spokes. The closer we get to Christ, the more we will be like Him. And He is the truth. And it's impossible for us to get close to that hub and be divisive to the others that are in Christ. The problem is, we're not serving the same master when we can't, as we get close together, and we do not want to be humble and teachable and taught of Christ. It's not for me to judge who. It's just needed for me to make sure that I'm, but our life is to be a narrow path, getting ever narrower as we come to the end. All that God has given us should be cleansed and sanctified to His service. We should clear the King's highway, God's ways of doing things, in order that God's messenger shall not be impeded as they try to advance. We should come into working order, into perfect unity with one another. Have you gathered what yet? Why over 20 years ago I did a collection of perfect unity? Have you heard that very many quotes here this afternoon? So it wasn't a miraculous thing. I mean, I'm not a genius. It's a simple truth that she just points out over and over. Let us pray with one another, putting away everything that would keep us from entering into and following the narrow path which it leads to everlasting life. Are we going to be hay and stubble? Are we going to be God's precious things? Inspiration points out many times about the similarities of the two. Everyone is the first to attend to his own individual case. Then he is to act in perfect unity with his brother. The hearts of the believers are to be the heart of Christ. Every impulse is to beat in harmony with the heart of Christ. If our heartbeat is in unison with his, and someone else is in unison with his, we will have no division. That doesn't mean we need to study something else. That's a part of getting closer and closer and closer to that house. We are to be one with Christ and one with each other, that the world may believe that God has sent his Son into the world. Do we believe that? Do we believe that God had a Son to send into this world?
Yes.
There are to be no separate parties in God's work. Every man to whom God has entrusted a message has his specific work. And this is to be done under the great master work. Form no separate parties. In their ministry, God's servants are to be essentially one. Each person has an individuality of his own, which he is not to lose in any other man. Yet he is to work in perfect unity with his brother and honor. God's workers are to prefer one another. We are to respect the others above ourselves. Each person has an individuality of his own to which he is not to lose another man. Yet he is to work perfect unity with his brother and honor. God's workers are to prefer one another. No worker is to set himself up as a criterion. No worker is to speak disrespectful of his fellow worker, treating him as an inferior. Under God, each is to do his appointed work, respected and loved and encouraged by his fellow workers. Review and Herald, December 11, 1900. Selected Messages 217. The men who have been placed in the office are to carry forward their appointed work. By working humbly with God, they are learners how to bring their different lines into perfection. There is to be perfect unity among the workers. They are to respect and uphold one another, each esteeming the other better than himself. How many different ways can we say it? The most convincing argument we can give to the world of Christ's mission is to be found in perfect unity. Such oneness as exists between the Father and the Son is to be manifest among all who believe the truth. Those who are thus united in implicit obedience to the Word of God will be filled with power. We want the power of God working through us. How to have perfect unity is with drawing nigh to God. Come the same, you cannot draw nigh to God and come to the same cross with our hearts blended. And God is to be glorified in us. Notebook Labors 31. Never did I see as now the necessity of thorough sanctification of God. We teach the truth, but do we practice it? The same can be said about inner truth. Sabbath, righteous by faith, working with one another. God is to be glorified. I'm going to skip over because it's almost repetitive. Our time is going. But here's one here I know I need to read. What do we do with independent views? Independent views. Independent beliefs. Independent ways of looking at things. Third volume of the Testimonies, 428. There have never been individuals, independent minds, who have claimed that they were right, that God has specially taught them, impressed and led them. Each has a theory of his own, views peculiar to himself, and each claims that his views are in accordance with the Word of God. Each one has a different theory and faith, yet each claims special light from God. These draw away from the body and teach, and each one in a separate church to himself. All these cannot be right, yet they all claim be led by the Lord. The word of inspiration is not yea and nay, but yea and amen. Satan's plan to take possession of humans' minds and that he may bring division, discord, and a party spirit. He seeks to create division among the people of God, that they may be weakened, that they're influences for good in the world will be lessened. God's people work in unity with one another. There will be no discordant opinions among those who are taught of God. True saints are one spirit in action. The Holy Spirit binds them together, and all the powers of hell cannot break it up. She doesn't use that exact words. But all the power of satanic agencies cannot break this. It's one and the same. A separate look, 322. Testimonies of Ministers, page 30, and also on page 503. And sometimes I like to give multiple references because she puts the same quote in different settings. If hearts are teachable, there will be no divisions among us. I just read another one. I think it's in the presentation one tomorrow. Is that if we're a teacher, we need to be a pupil. If we're a teacher, and God's calls. She doesn't even say God's calls, but if we are a teacher, we need to be a learner or a pupil. Last year, just over a year ago, I received a lot of files from the Claude Holmes collection. I shared some of this information with some of you last year. I have thoroughly gone through that. This first really big division, you know, there's some quotes here this morning about when Ellen White laid the rep. The first problem came in 1919 Bible Conference. B.G. Wilkinson wanted to attend that. A.G. Daniel said, no, we don't need you. Well, he's really saying they don't want you. Because he had a few people to contend with. He knew that B.G. Wilkinson and Judge Washburn, my parents were friends with him, by the way. So I try to get everything I can get, basically, that has his name on it. After about 3 days, A.G. Daniel said, Wilkinson, you need to come. I've opened Pandora's box. You need to come. It's out of control. It's been out of control ever since. I have a letter that was written in 1948. Concerning the change of teachings at Emmanuel Missionary College. You know where that's at? That was in the theology department. That is now called Andrews University. What was happening is the students were going there well-grounded. And they were being taught things that they knew was error. And they went to the teacher and says, hey, we want to, but the setting that I want to set is a general conference teachings, the official teachings of the general conference at that time were still the old views. Now, if I worked for Ford Motor Company and was kind of up a little bit working, I was just a common laborer. I drove a Cadillac and told everybody they need to own a Cadillac. Would that work very well? There was a teacher there that was teaching his own views. And when he was brought and questioned, he says, because that's not what we teach, he says, why teach the Bible and the Bible only? I know there's a few things that Sister White, but I teach the Bible and the Bible only. Now, there was a policy that they had back in the 1940s. Now, I'm going to read that policy. There's a threefold union. First thing, the Bible. Now, I beseech you, brother, in the name of Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same things, that there be no division among you. 1 Corinthians 1:10. The second one, the spirit of prophecy. I have seen the dangers of messengers. This is Ellen White speaking. The danger of messengers running off from the important points of present truth to dwell upon subjects that were not calculated to unite the flock of God and sanctify the soul. Satan will take every possible advantage to injure the cause. We must keep before the world a united front. Satan will triumph to see differences among Seventh-day Adventists. My husband, she wrote this in 1877. My husband had some ideas on some points differing from the views taken by his brother. I was shown that however true his views were, is she endorsing what James White believed? Yes. She says, I was shown that however true his views were, God did not call him to put them in front before his brethren and create different ideas. Does that mean he always has to be silent? No. But there is a procedure and a way to bring in new ideas. It's not from the pulpit. There's another one. That's in Council of the Writers, by the way, page 76. The General Conference Committee, and this is taken from 1948 Ministerial Reading Council, which is a little manual. No teacher, editor, minister, or member has the privilege to make such studies of private opinions public to his class, his congregation, his readers, unless he knows that these studies are in full harmony with the teachings of the Adventist Church. And further, that the time for making them public is timely. This is the only way we can hold together and follow the light given us in the Lord. Ever since that time, that this certain Bible teacher has only gotten worse. Now I don't even think they even know about this policy. Danger of falling man. I already mentioned that. Jeremiah 17:7 through verse 10. Then I have here my notes, the history of the judges. Did we hear that earlier today? If you take Judges chapters 2 and go to chapter 13, you will see a flip-flop. Had a righteous leader. People tore down the idols and became worshipers of God. Then he died, and then they went the other way and started worshiping idols. Sometimes it was 20 years, sometimes as much as 80 years. But whatever the leader did, everybody followed. You cannot follow any man, including Alan Stump. Uh-oh, I said I wasn't going to say names. Including Jack Barney, including any human. The only time we should encourage somebody to listen to somebody is when we first bring them to the knowledge of the truth. When they give up being babes, they need to be taught to stand alone. I brought somebody to the truth back years ago, and that's another whole testimony. Pastor made him a visit one day, and he says, I want to know who taught you all this. He knew who it was. He didn't know me personally. Never, I don't think he ever met me. He said, well, Jack Barney did, but when I asked him a question, he opened the Bible with the spirit of prophecy and answered it. So it wasn't him. We need to learn. I won't say something else that might not be liked here. Stop reading all the newsletters from page one to page whatever. Spending more time in the Word. My wife will tell you that most newsletters, and we don't get a lot, most newsletters I just skim. It's hard for me to read an article in a newsletter. Because I have too much other time that I want to spend on doing other research. I'm going to say something else. This, I thought, was only an issue with the people in the structure. I'll tell you the honest truth. When I first came to meet with the Godhead believers, we didn't have any Godhead believers around where we lived. This was in 08, 07, 08. I was amazed. At the things that I've learned in the last couple of years. Many of them do not understand righteous by faith. Too many of them do not believe in the spirit of prophecy. Brother, there's something wrong here. Well, I'm the Bible and the Bible only. Several ministry leaders have told me personally that. Let me read you a couple of statements. I did a research. I mean, we have wonderful ways of researching these things. In a few seconds, you can find how many times, how many hits in the spirit of prophecy. I put in testimonies, spirit, and God. 696 hits. I needed to narrow it down a little bit, so I put testimonies of the Spirit of God. 74 hits. Testimony of His Spirit, of God's Spirit. And the testimonies is the writings of the Spirit of Prophecy. 75 things. I reviewed a few of those, not very many. So I didn't have time, but I indexed all those. But in many of those references, when you do those, she did not differentiate between the testimonies and the Bible. She put them on an equal plane. Let me give you an example. The doubt and even displeasure of the testimonies of the Spirit of God. Another one. That wasn't what I was looking for. The light God has given them through His Word and the testimonies of His Spirit. It's the same Spirit on the two. She also says, the testimonies are the Spirit of God, or, finish it for me, the spirit of the devil. If they're not Spirit of God, and they are the spirit of the devil, and you're convinced of that, don't fool people by quoting a few little verses and act like you believe in the testimonies. And when you're back to the corner, oh, I'm a Bible-only believer. Paul did not use his own writings to prove things. He based his on the Old Testament. Ellen White always pointed to the Bible. Ellen White has been examined, cross-examined. If you want to find out some, get some disbelief on the spirit of apology, just go to the internet. That's all you got to do. If you don't want to believe it, just go to the internet and believe the internet. We're given a choice. We can believe what we want to believe. But don't get up and quote a couple of spirit of prophecy and things, and then when you get back to the corner in the theology, well, Ellen White wasn't a theologian. When we go through the testimonies or any different thing, we like to put the Bible verse. And I tell you, you just go to the index of Desire of Ages and index of the Great Controversy. Just pick those two, but you can pick any book. And look at all the scriptural indexes that you'll find. Hundreds. Let me read you two. I'm almost at the end, by the way. I was told I could go a little bit over. The Bible and the Bible alone. You know what we were here? Let me finish the paragraph of what she wrote. Laid up in the heart and blessed by the Spirit of God can make man right and keep him right. All that I may say will have no weight with you or your wife unless a work is wrought in your heart. You will make objections to the testimonies. And unless the Spirit of God shall have a controlling power, conscience will be warped. The heart, the foundation of the issues of life, is kept only when the Word of God is brought to the soul and rules there. You have a large amount of self that is being holding you away from God. That's from 1880 Materials, page 194. To disregard light is to reject it. The rejection of light leaves man's captives bound about by chains of darkness and unbelief. It is not alone those who openly reject the testimonies or who cherish doubt concerning them that are on dangerous ground. To discard light is to reject it. God will not dwell with those who reject the truth. For all who disregard light, disregard its author. Is the author of the testimonies Ellen White? No. She didn't like being a servant of the Lord. We just read that recently in our devotions. Being God's messenger is not a pleasant thing to do. She really wanted to be like Dwight Moody and had a home for people, children, and things that were homeless. That was Ellen White. And that's a lot of reason why a lot of times she had a number of people in her home that she helped. That's what she really loved to do. And we know that early on, she tried to speak some pleasant things because things would be going smoothly in the early years. They would leave town for a month or two and come back to Battle Creek. And she wasn't even welcome in her own church. Rumors went around. James White's teaching her and learning, you know, she's been influenced by different things. She's always talking negative, always telling people what's wrong with them. Nothing's new. That's Old Testament repeated over and over. She did not. And she tried to be a little bit more friendly at one time, and she saw the frown of God. She never wanted to see that again. The book I would recommend you to read is a book, The Truth About Angels. I don't know if you've ever gone through it. We went through it not long ago. Angels are saddened. Angels are made happy. Angels have a smile. Angels frown. What's our angel going to do? What's our angel going to do with the way we act? With the way we live? May God help us to press together, to unite with Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, how many more years is it going to take? Jesus went to the religious leaders, beginning of his ministry. Is he going to have to go to somebody else today?
Why not?
Are you going to give up your crown? Dear brothers and sisters, did you hand those things out? You don't need to do it right now. Just make sure you get a questionnaire because I'd like to know a little bit about what you're thinking. Just wait until after we have prayer, Mike. Just wait until we have prayer.
Okay.
This is the open prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you being with us here and guiding us and directing us and leading us. Oh, Father, help us to press together, because if we don't, we'll separate from you. Please be with us and guide us each. Help us to be among those who Christ prayed for that will answer his prayer. Unite with you and live eternally with you, Father. We cannot comprehend. Oh, Father, please be with each one of us and guide us. We pray that we will contemplate these things, that we will live the Christian life, that we will esteem others better than ourselves, and that we will put you first in all we do and deny self. All this, Father, we ask in your dear Son's name. Amen.